In the next few sessions, we're going to talk about dimension reduction, which means reducing the number of columns in some way. We're going to start by looking at a method called principal components analysis, and later on we'll talk about alternatives. Principal components analysis plays a pivotal role in many applications that you know in practice. What are we trying to do again? We have multiple records, but what we're worried about right now is the multiplicity in measurements. For example, this is from the previous US elections. We had many candidates, and each candidate had distinct opinions on a large set of issues. Is there a way that we can reduce all the measurement on these many issues into a smaller set somehow? That's what we're going to try and address with principal components analysis. Now, PCA, or principal components analysis, is useful not only for data compression, when we're talking about compressing columns, but also for two other very useful goals. One is the goal of learning relationships between different measurements. And this is very common in the social sciences. For instance, when people are studying surveys and they want to find questions that are measuring the same thing. PCA is often used for that as well. In fact, if you've heard about factor analysis, that's just PCA with a cherry on top. It's a little tweak on top of PCA that's aimed at addressing this goal of learning relationships between measurements. A third very nice use of PCA is being able to visualize multidimensional data, meaning lots and lots of measurements, in a 2D or maybe 3D space. So the idea of projecting the data that's in high dimension, because we have multiple measurements, into a certain space. That was also the photo on our cover slide. If you go back and see, we're looking at a shadow of a 3D tree onto a 2D pavement. We're going to get back and use the same example that we used in the cluster analysis sessions, where we have a bunch of measurements on programs, business undergraduate programs in the United States. And again, these measurements include information about student quality and program quality and placement information. And unlike clustering, where we were looking at the universities and trying to condense them into groups, now we're trying to see whether we can condense the different measurements into fewer columns. So again, we're going to use PCA in this case to try and identify relationships between these different measurements, to try and reduce the number of columns in terms of finding the information that's contained in them in a smaller number of measurements. And thirdly, we want to be able to visualize all these universities on a 2D plot so that we can see which are close or different in terms of these particular measurements. Here's the big idea behind PCA. Suppose I have a bunch of grades on all my students. I have two grades, quiz one and quiz two. And here's a scatter plot of these grades for all my students. Each student is a dot here. Now, suppose that I need to condense this information into a single grade. In other words, I'm not allowed to hold in memory two numbers for each student, but only one. How can I condense them? Well, an obvious thought is, well, just take the average, right? But by the average, of course, you're losing some information. The idea in PCA is not to take an average, but to take a weighted average. And the idea there is to say, well, where is there the largest variability? What's the dimension in which we have a lot of differentiation between grades of students? And this black line here shows me exactly the dimension where I have the biggest variability across grades. Then if I take the orthogonal 90 degrees line, that is actually the dimension that has a very, very small, the smallest amount of variance in grades. So the idea in principal components, if you think of it very graphically, is to take the original scatterplot axes that we had and turn them around, rotate them to the ones that we see plotted right now. Then we've remixed our data up so that now one axis has a lot of variation and the other has very little variation. Then we can throw out the axis with a small variation and remain with a single measurement that has as much variation as possible. Now, while variability, variance, variation are considered a bad thing when you think about quality, for instance, In this case, we're thinking of variation as information. Measurements that have larger variation are more informative because they're separating out or telling us something about the records. Whereas measurements that have the same numbers practically for everyone are really not informative, and those are ones that are we're less reluctant to drop out. So this is the idea of PCA graphically. How do we start? Let's say we have P measurements. We're going to use these P original measurements, put it into the algorithm, and outside we're going to get P principal components. These are the same number of new columns, so we start with P and we end with P, and each one of them is a weighted average of the original P measurements, but with different weights. So you'll say, well, where is the compression? Where is the data reduction? Here's the story. Although the original measurements are very likely to be correlated because there's always information overlap between measurements, the output of PCA, we get P measurements that are completely uncorrelated, meaning there's no information overlap across variables. We can order them by variance so that the first one has the largest variance and the last one has the smallest variance. And the idea there is going to be, we can actually keep only a subset of these principal components, the ones that have the largest amount of variance, and drop out all the rest. So that's how we get compression by PCA. When is PCA going to be useful? You notice I mentioned the term information overlap. So think about it again. Information overlap can be measured by something like correlation if we have numerical measurements. And the more overlap there is, it means that we can squeeze the information that's in, let's say, two variables into a single variable. Think of perfect correlation. If two measurements have exactly a correlation of one, I can actually throw one of them out without losing any information. So again, when is this going to be best? When there is overlap. That's when we'll get big compression and a small number of principal components will capture most of the information from the original measurements. Let's go behind the scenes and look a little bit at the mechanics of PCA. I'm using notation x1 to xp as the input measurements, and our outputs from this technique are going to be called PC1 to PCP. And of course, we do want to only keep the first ones and drop the last ones if everything works well. Now, each PC is going to be a weighted average. So PCI, PC1 or 2 or whichever one, is simply going to be a weighted average of the X's with a certain set of weights. Now, these are special weights. That's the trick behind PC. These weights are special in that, first of all, we have to normalize them somehow. So the sum of squared weights is going to be equal to 1. And the choice of these weights is going to make these PCs ordered by their variance. So PC1 is going to be having the largest variance, and PCP will have the smallest variance. Lastly, what's special about these weights is that when we look at any correlation between pairs of PCs, it's going to be 0. So the question is, how do you find these weights? What are the magical methods for finding the weights? Let me just show you a little bit of what's going behind the scenes further deeper, and I think you'll understand where the weights are coming from. So remember again, high variance means a lot of information. Let's look at a certain PC, and I'm using the formula that we had on the previous slide, which presented the PC as a weighted average of the original X's. Let me write this out now. This might look a little scary, but let's just look step by step. So PC is a weighted average. Our first weight is A(i1) times x1. When we're taking a variance, the weight, which is just a number, goes outside and squares, and then we just have the variance of x1. And similarly, we do the same thing for all the other weights and the x's. However, because the original measurements might be correlated, we also have covariances coming in. If you forgot this, you might want to go back to your stats course. And that's why we see all these terms in the second row here, where we have multiplications of the weights and covariances. What we're doing when we're looking for weights is we're looking for weights aij that maximize the variance of this PC here while keeping it uncorrelated with the next PCs that are coming. What I want you to remember from this slide is that to compute these weights or discover these PCs, all we need from the data are the covariances and the variances between the original measurements. I do not need the raw data. Okay, with that in mind, let's get back to our example. So what am I going to ask myself? Well, can I just take this and compute variances and covariances and put them in and get PCs? I'm going to have the same problem that we had in cluster analysis. Because different measurements here have different scales, the measurements that have very large scales, such as expenses, are going to distort and take over the whole computation. So once again, we're going to have to normalize or standardize the data before we go into PCA. You can use Excel to use normalization, and here's a function that's easy to use there. And of course, you can normalize in other ways, such as scaling everything to 0-1. In PCA, there's an interesting shortcut. It turns out that instead of first normalizing the data and then running PCA, you can simply operate, instead of on the covariance matrix that we just talked about, you can operate on the correlation matrix. And that would be equivalent to working on the normalized variables. Okay? So rather than standardize manually, you can replace the covariance matrix with a correlation matrix as input into the procedure. Note that whether you run PCA with normalization or without normalization, which is equivalent to with on the correlation matrix or on the covariance matrix, you will get different results. Okay, let's take a look at both of these. First, let's look at the covariance matrix, and this is easy to just obtain in Excel. And what I have here is a covariance between our six measures for these universities. Remember that we're talking about variance in terms of information. How do I measure variance in PCA? Well, we're going to look at the variances, which in the covariance matrix are the elements on the diagonal. And we're simply going to add these all up, and that will be the total variance, or what we're calling the overall information that is contained in these measurements. The idea is to take this overall bucket of information and redistribute it in a different way so that we have one PC that has lots of information and the next PC lesser and lesser, and the last ones will have very little information. I can do the same in terms of the correlation matrix down here at the bottom. Again, I'm going to look at the diagonal as the information gathering piece and think about the information as just the sum of this diagonal. In Excel Minor, I can simply use the principal components analysis menu in the data reduction and exploration menu. You choose the variables that you want to enter in there, and then you can ask Excel Minor either to use the covariance matrix or to use the correlation matrix. Remember that using the correlation matrix is equivalent to first normalizing the data. Here's the output that I receive. The column called component 1 is actually PC1, and here are the weights. This is a weighted average of the original variables with weights equivalent to the numbers that are here, 0.4577 times SAT plus 0.427 times top 10, etc. The second component has these weights. And we can see that we have six components. That's because we had six original measurements, and this is the last component. Now look at the table just below it. This is telling us how much information or variance each one of these components contains. The first component contains the largest variance of all the other PCs. In terms of percentages, out of a total of 100%, the first component contains almost 77% of the information. The next one contains 13%, and then it drops pretty quickly. You can also look at the cumulative percentage and see that we're with only three components, we already have almost 95% of the information. We can drop 4, 5, and 6 and only lose 5% of the information. Let's first look at the first goal, which is learning the relationships between the different measurements. How do we do this? Well, we have to concentrate on the weights that we just received. These weights, are also called coefficients, are the key to understanding what is the relationship between the original X's and the resulting PCs. Take a look at this first component at the weights and see if you can answer this question right here.